So,
this one's drunk.
We're gonna name all the subscribers.
Okay.
The military guys in the set.
Oh, okay.
So we'll come back to you guys.
Yes.
Later.
Who gets to be Major Malfunction?
Maybe you.
I probably think that's what my father would tell you.
Oh no.
Oh yes. Welcome back to Brick Me Up, Scotty. I'm not Scotty. He is.
Yeah. Welcome back. So today we're doing the military from Oxford Block. This is one of the sets, and our special guest is Sean. I would introduce you, but maybe you should introduce yourself. Who are you from?
I didn't know it was that kind of video.
I don't know.
Yes, I also have a video channel. I review Chinese language films called The Silver Spleen. It is not generally a very child-friendly channel. I'll just admit that up front. But today, I'm going to make sure that I don't say anything inappropriate, or if I do, it would be something children won't understand.
Let's keep it clean.
Yes.
If not, I'm going to just cut you out.
Yes.
But anyway, Sean has an awesome channel. If you guys want to know more about Hong Kong films, or you don't know about Hong Kong films and you want to learn, I'll put his link in the description.
Yes.
And you're also like a military guy, right? So that's why
Not
I'm bringing
really.
You here.
Well, I mean, look, full disclosure, I was in the National Guard for about 6 months, went to Fort Benning, and my knee exploded inside of 10 days. So full disclosure. But I do like to read a lot. So I end up with a brain full of essentially useless information that hopefully will be of some benefit to your viewers.
Yeah, you know, so hopefully I get to play with the toys and Sean can give us a little bit of what these things are, because I have no idea what they are.
Right. So, I'll do my best, and I'm sure that I'll be wrong at least once and people will point it out.
Yeah, we'll just have as much fun as we can, all right?
Yes, exactly.
So, today we are looking at Oxford Block's military. There's no description. I can't read
it. It just says military.
Military.
Yes.
OM33020 1,337 pieces.
Good grief.
Whoa, but look, what you see is what you get when you buy the set. You get all this.
You get quite a lot.
So, Sean, which one excites you the most? Which one should we look at first?
Let's start with this. Field artillery piece, not self-propelled. I'm afraid to touch these things, and you'll see why momentarily.
It's okay. They'll let them fall apart on you, because you can see how sturdy these are.
It's a nice level of detail.
I kind of want to say something dirty about it, but you know.
Like what?
Yeah, we just keep that to ourselves.
Sometimes a cigar is just a cigar.
But you know, what's cool is when I built this, what I like about it is to have these things on the side here.
Yes.
Like, it's just simple.
Which are in real life, that's exactly what it does. Okay, here we go, useless knowledge. Assuming this is an artillery piece, one of the things that you do with artillery is you use things like geometry and geography and maps. And so you have to at least start off with everything being level. So this allows the soldiers who set it up to make sure that it's completely level so that the stress from firing the weapon doesn't knock it over.
I had fun building it.
Yeah.
Just, you know, it was a very simple build. And I guess the steering wheels on the side just make it go up and down, right?
That most likely is an anti-aircraft. If it goes this high up in the air, it would be designed to shoot into the air so that you get air burst. I would call this an anti-aircraft gun, AA gun.
AA gun.
Yes. Okay, sandbags. Now, what's funny is these remind me of like the Tamiya 1/35th scale, short of the Lego type connectors. Can I say that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Brick connectors.
Brick Lego. Connectors, I'm sorry. They look almost identical, like almost the same size. Will this?
Yeah.
Oh, it will.
Yeah, that's what's really cool.
Nice.
This is something that was new to me, but it is a little bit loose. You'll see it's coming apart.
Yeah.
Because they don't really have like,
whoops.
Oh. You look underneath. There's no clutch.
No traction.
It. Yeah.
No traction, no friction.
But you can totally design the wall however you like it.
Right.
I just copied the manual. And they do come with extra sandbags.
Oh, nice. Dragon's teeth.
These, that's new to me, dragon teeth.
These are, believe it or not, anti-tank traps. They're not necessarily designed to get the tank to stick to it. It's more what they now call area denial. You would put these up, and you'll see a lot of these if you watch the History Channel about the Atlantic Wall, the German defenses in France. You put these in places to make it where the tank can't go through because the tank would have to go around them, but if there's two hills here, you can shut the place off. I'm not sure about the design. Quite simple, but effective.
I had no idea. I just see these in like Call of Duty and...
Yeah, exactly.
Take it off right there.
Aha! Here. Storage facilities, which also obviously double as place to sit, I suppose.
I think a lot of you guys, we see these in a lot of other sets.
Boxes.
Just like boxes.
Yes.
This one actually has space inside, but there's nothing inside there. It's just empty. But we got plenty of accessories, which I'm going to show you later.
Sometimes, you know, this is where, for example, you could get lots of chocolate and cigarettes. Things that you could use to make new friends in France at night. Aha!
Barrels.
55-gallon drums.
These are always fun to shoot in video games.
Exactly, yes, because they always explode. The 1969 film Battle of the Bulge, the Germans were trying to capture the Allied fuel supplies, and so as the German tanks are approaching, and they roll them down the hill and shoot them, and they explode in a very satisfying manner, and I'm assuming that may have been an inspiration for the now de rigueur habit of having exploding barrels in video games, which is good actually, because now children learn,
right,
be careful of these things because they will explode.
Dangerous goods.
Yes.
This is what I know from Saving Private Ryan, yes, and Dunkirk and
landing craft. Will this?
You find out. Let's see if it open up. Clunk. There you go.
Landing craft, obviously. This would be considered, I think, LCI, landing craft infantry, because it would be packed with men, and it would obviously come into the beach, drop this down, and people would run out and hopefully not get shot by a German, as you saw in Saving Private Ryan. It features, let's see, at least what
there's... I don't know, I just put this gun here. I mean, it has like two areas that you can kind of put extra guns, and you know, these are part of the accessories.
Right.
I don't know, I probably put another one there.
This is a model of the Browning 30 caliber machine gun, air-cooled.
You know those guns.
I know this stuff because it's pointless.
To me, it's just a machine gun.
Right. Actually, the people who operated the vehicles were in the Navy, usually carrying Army or Marines.
As far as build goes, to me it just seems kind of plain, kind of boring.
Sure.
I don't know if that's the way it was, like...
But yeah, they were very utilitarian.
And the stickers are okay, they're kind of like...
Yeah, I noticed, supposed to look like it? Is it supposed to look
like
sort of
transparent,
weathered and abused?
Yeah. That's okay. It's got scratch marks on there, so it's
abused,
but it would have been nice if it was like printed. I always preferred printed over stickers, especially these are like transparency. Yeah. This is a very, very simple build.
Let's take a look at this model.
Yeah, now this has to be one of my favorites, I think. I think this is my favorite from the set, just because it looks complicated. The build was fun.
Mm-hmm.
It is a little bit delicate, and Sean found that out earlier.
Yes.
I guess it has a more sophisticated look than the other stuff that we're seeing. You know,
yes.
It doesn't look so plain. It looks like a war plane, if I'm saying it. But anyway, go ahead.
This is a reproduction, let's not call it a model, a reproduction of the Vought F4U Corsair, which was a gull wing design, which kind of is done here. It was designed to work on aircraft carriers, and that's why the wings will fold up. However, what they found was that this aircraft wasn't really very good at landing on aircraft carriers. Whoops. See, that's why I made him do that.
Yeah, the wings actually come off pretty easy, just because secured on the top and not on the bottom.
Right.
But it does, if you want it to position it however you want to position it, it will like
stay
like
built
that.
A lot of the, the F4 Wildcat, the F6 Hellcat, they were designed so that you could put more of them on the actual ship. I don't know if the directions say this, but you put the insignia on backwards. The star, the point.
Shape. I don't know this.
That's okay. Like I said, for all we know, it could be. Yeah, see there, they put it on funny, but it doesn't really matter. The other thing
you want to correct the sticker for us?
No, I don't want to peel it off.
Was it OCD?
No, it's not OCD.
I peeled the sticker off on the last set and already kind of destroyed it, but I don't mind.
So no.
The flaps come up, move up and
nice.
Down, right? So
you
got the flat, movable flaps. The propeller, as far as build goes, it does kind of get loose here, this part sometimes.
It allows for maintenance of the radial engine.
The missiles and the bomb.
Rockets.
Rockets.
They didn't have missiles in World War II.
It's all the same to me, man. But this is the bomb, right? But this actually comes loose sometimes when you're building it,
sure.
Like you saw earlier.
Which, yeah, and you don't want that to happen in real life. And the wheels, actually, the wheels retract.
Yes, they do.
See? Retractable landing gear.
That's actually pretty cool.
What I like about this, and actually a lot of them, is you can tell what it was supposed to, like it's an actual design and they've managed to recreate it pretty well, at least to the point where you recognize exactly which aircraft it's supposed to be.
And then you have the cockpit here, it doesn't open up.
In real life it would just slide back. But again, this is really interesting and nice, I like it.
Yeah, I like this a lot. Cool.
All right.
My favorite one.
Yeah. Should we go small? All right. A pillbox, because it resembles a box in which one would put pills.
Oh, the bunker.
Except this one's sort of small. It's another word for it. Actually, I don't know if you can see this. I like this.
Yeah, I like that. Go ahead. Break it.
No, I don't want to break it.
As far as build goes, really small. There's nothing to talk home about it. There's one piece here. Let me see if I can pull this off.
All right.
This piece. This is new to me. Usually they'd have like bricks that stack on top of each other and then, you know, you have your wall. I've never seen this piece before.
Nice.
So this is like a...
It's got a lovely texture.
Yeah, it's got texture on it. All right.
Okay.
We're done with the pillowcase, pillbox.
Okay.
Big boy?
Yes. This is LVT, landing vehicle tank. Came to be used late in the war, especially in the Pacific. One of the lovely design features, and I have to kind of go back to this. Here, this lands on the beach and shoot me. This one lands on the beach and here, I'll have to turn this around. Now imagine that you're facing the beach. You could let people out the back way, which tended to get a lot fewer of them shot. This is also tracked. It's an armored vehicle. It has tracks. So it could drive up off the beach, which also helped.
Very loose, but it moves very nice.
Like it's supposed to.
Yeah, it doesn't fall apart or anything. That's I guess if you had like a, well, that thing fell apart.
Oops.
For me, the tiles, again, it's just because it looks kind of blandish. Yeah. I mean, if you look at, I'll show Sean the tank from last time, but the other tank had like that rustic metallic feel. This just feels more plain, I guess.
Yeah.
And I don't know, they put these things underneath. I guess these are just like stands. So, you know, you can take those off if you wanted to. Maybe they just don't want it to roll on the ground.
Yeah.
The build is solid. Look at that, it's a solid build. It does open up on the inside there. You got a chair. Seat. That's it, no control panel, no nothing. It's just plain.
It's fine.
Chair, you know? Yeah. There you go. Anything else you want to say about this?
No, not much. I mean, again, it's kind of fascinating that they can create something that is very recognizable. Jeep. Why do we call it a Jeep? Because originally, when this was designed, it was known as a vehicle general purpose, or GP. GP. Jeep. Jeep. Right? So that's why it's, why is it called a Jeep? That's why. The thing about the original Jeeps was that you could take them almost anywhere. They were four-wheel drive, they were extremely durable, and you could festoon, there's a good word, you could festoon them with weapons or whatever else you needed. As far as the build?
Build for me? I think it's actually pretty cool. I like it when they actually go really small on builds, but they still make it look really detailed.
Yes.
And I think to me, this being small, they could have cheapened out and made it worse, but it looks right. Like a Jeep to me.
Yeah.
I like the backpack on the back, and I do like the spare tire.
I do. I like the tires really well. In general. I like that they're sort of soft. It's sturdy, like you said. Yeah. It won't fall apart.
There we go.
The motorcycle with the sidecar. I appreciate these outsized brake lights and headlights because they didn't necessarily have those in real life, but that's okay. This is one of those things. I think it's important.
Cool. I think the build is fine. It's just an extra bike for the set.
Yeah.
With a sidecar. Pretty cool.
Very nice.
Okay, so for the minifigures, I'm gonna name based on a few videos back. I'm just gonna pick random people. And if your name didn't get called, just put your name in the comment. I'll make sure you get in the next few videos. Yeah. All right? Because these videos are going like all over in different order. I have no idea. So let's take a look at the first one. This is the boss man, Zaslavsky Kozlov.
Zaslavsky Kozlov.
Zaslavsky Kozlov. You're the boss man.
Exactly.
You got some nice shades on there. And he's got his baton.
Yes, he has his baton because he's in charge. And who is this?
This is, looks very happy to go to war.
Yes.
With his vest on.
Well, yeah, that helps, actually.
Illuminati Bricks.
Illuminati Bricks.
Yeah.
Right.
But this one is Ko-Amin Samudera. There you are.
Okay.
I hope I said your name right.
Right.
You're also looking very jolly going into war.
Okay.
The goggle dude is Eric Nipple.
Okay.
Well, Eric, there you are.
Yes.
With your goggles. And thankfully, no nips showing. This one is the one with another hat. MRC Cuber. One day you'll win a giveaway.
Yeah.
Don't worry. But there you are.
But until then, yes. There you go. Is that a mustache?
Yeah, this guy's just wearing a vest. No, I think it's just like his chin. A little smirk on his face. Menu, that's you.
Okay.
So there you are.
Very nice.
Going to war with a smirk on your face. Potato Masher is
Ein Stielgranat.
Robert Schell.
Aha.
Who is noticing all my gaming shirts.
Oh, okay.
So, you know.
So there you go.
Potato Masher.
Yes.
Go make some potato.
Cool. Smashed potatoes, if you will.
This one.
Fairly standard, wearing his backpack.
Looks totally terrified. He looks really scared.
Yes. Or he's enjoying a USO comedy show and he's laughing.
This is Martin Darup.
Right.
Martin actually won. You won the last giveaway.
And again, the people with the questionable eye design.
See, look at the eyes are so big.
Yeah.
But hey, more alert.
That's true.
Nice backpack on the back. And yeah. That is Michael Ho. That's you. Sorry you had problems with the Lapita music box build. And you know, if you guys aren't happy being named as these minifigures, I'll name
too
you
bad.
Again. Yeah, that, and I'll name you again anyway.
Yeah.
Let's see who's this one.
Believe me, you don't want me to name you.
Home Abroad 68.
Aha. Uh-huh.
I think I named you before, but I'm just gonna name you again. There you go.
Hold your own, broad. Oh!
Driving on the bike and being lost.
Sure.
This is Lost Wits.
Aha, perfect.
Aha, there you go.
Where
Lost Wits,
we?
There you are.
Yes. This is the NKVD, if you've seen Enemy at the Gates. These are the guys who would stand behind the Russians, making sure that when the order was given to move towards the Germans, nobody got the quote-unquote bright idea of going, this is stupid, I'm going to run away, because these people would shoot them. So, I mean, I hope you don't mind that historical association, but we're sort of running out of figurines. So this is...
You. This is Sean.
Me. Okay, I'll take that job. That's fine with me. Right. I get to wear a nice hat, and I have my own pistol. The special flamethrower person.
This is John Howard.
Aha. Uh-huh.
There you are, John. I think you're the coolest looking one.
Exactly.
Just because you have a flamethrower.
Yes.
But you know, you can always switch the flamethrower with the other figures and, you know,
yes,
have fun with that. Mm. Okay, so the set actually comes with tons of accessories.
Very
and, you know,
thorough.
I've already sorted them in boxes and all that kind of stuff.
Very
but
generous
here's some set. Weapons. Look at all the weapons there.
Yes.
Look at all that.
And again, a lot of these are what I would consider, within reason, historically accurate. There's a M14, what they commonly call the Dushka, the Russian version of the 50 caliber. That looks sort of like a MG42, the German late Second World War. M3 grease gun. This is the Russian Papasha PPSH-41. They have this little extra thing in here so that the figurine can hold it. The 1928 Thompson, some hand grenades.
I'm just gonna keep quiet and listen to you.
Early World War II bazooka. And it includes repeats.
Nice,
see,
there you
my
go.
My head is full of useless information.
If you want more useless information,
yeah, just
let
ask
us know
me.
In the comment.
Yeah.
And I'll bring Sean back again over and over and over.
Or not if you tell him not to.
Yeah, and by the way, Sean's the one that actually made the shelves behind us.
Yeah.
So thank you, Sean, for that.
You're welcome, thank you. I had fun doing it.
So thank you guys so much for watching the video.
Yes,
please don't forget
you.
To like, comment, and subscribe. And go check out Sean's channel, The Silver Spleen.
Yes.
Yeah, not for kids.
No, definitely not for children.
But, you know, enjoy his...
Neither am I.
Hong Kong movie reviews.
Yes.
And maybe I'll jump on his channel at some point.
He definitely, yes.
Do some
we're
collaboration.
Working on that.
All right, you guys, so until next time...
Brick us up. Look at this guy, he won't die.
One more bomb.
Excellent.
And of course, well, I should mention that Lego cannot do war, or they choose not
they
to.
They choose not to, yeah.
Yeah, to do war things because it's violent or whatever.
Right. However, Oxford is what, a South Korean company?
Yep.
And you know, yeah,
but
just complain about me in the comments. I get that a lot on my own channel.
Poor guy. I'm so sorry for you.
No, you don't. Do you want me to tell you a pillbox story from my great uncle John?
Yeah, we have enough time. Let's
all
do it.
Right,
go for it. You guys want to hear it? Yeah.
Okay. Now, my grandfather that worked in the ball bearing factory, his brother-in-law, my grandmother's brother, my uncle Joe, was an engineer and spent 3 or 4 years in the Pacific Theater. And one of his jobs at one point in the war was that the soldiers would kind of move through an area and they didn't clear out every single pillbox. And so there would sometimes be Japanese soldiers in there who would not surrender, even though they would ask as politely as possible. And so they got in the habit of doing kind of a game where they would take an American hand grenade that has a 7-second fuse and you pull the pin and you'd throw it in there, sort of 1, 2, 3, 4, and the guy would take it 5, 6 and throw it back out. 7, it would explode back out. Right, so then what they would do is take an Australian hand grenade because those had 5-second fuses. And my uncle kind of laughed and said, it worked every time.
That's so. Kind of...
Yeah, but that's, you know, that's the nature of things.
Yeah, the reality, right?
It's not really a child-friendly story, I admit, but we can make the argument this isn't either.
Take the figures off here.
Ah! Die Flammenwerfer.
Hans, get the flamethrower.
Yes, Force 10 from Navarone, not a good film, but at one point Richard Kiel says to, again, Robert Shaw, the how you say Flammenwerfer, and Robert Shaw says, we say flamethrower. What is he holding a potato masher?
A grenade, right?
The colloquial term for the German hand grenades was the potato masher because it looked like something with which you could mash potatoes, not a hobby with a future.
I thought that was really a joke. They really called it a potato masher?
Yeah, they really did.
Okay, so these are dark tone. I'm scared to say like...
Black?
Black. Okay, so these are black guys, right?
They're black soldiers.
Black soldiers.
Yes.
And I understand that they had to print the eyes the way they did so that you can see the face. But they look really bad. They look so terrible, the eyes. They're just the printing.
Well...
Or they look like... You know what it is? They look like Japanese anime eyes.
Right.
They almost look too big, where the other figures are like super, super small. These guys' eyes are like super, super big.
Yeah.
And I didn't think they had to do it like that.
Right. But well, you know, Korea doesn't necessarily have the greatest track record.
Thank you guys so much for liking this channel. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. We'll bring you more, I promise you. So thank you for watching, and I'll catch you guys later. Bye-bye now.